Let's start with the drone. So the point of this is that we get our consonances very nice, exactly right, and in a sense there is an amplification of the note that is being held. Yeah. So it's about finding the tones in a sense that are in the acoustic of this building.
Oh.
My name is Niels Berentsen. I am a teacher of Renaissance and medieval music at the Royal Conservatoire of The Hague in the Netherlands. And I'm also a doctoral student at Leiden University and the Orpheus Institute in beautiful Ghent here in Flanders. I will be presenting to you today about an important part of my research on improvised polyphony, which is concerning 14th century polyphony, an area in which not a lot of work is yet being done. So you are seeing something which is very new and possibly in some cases you are going to see something here today that no one has heard or seen since about 600 years. The first example that we have shown you is this Benedict Camus Domino. This was, of course, not an improvisation. This was a written out piece, but we have strong reasons to suspect this reflects an improvisational practice of, in this case, the very, very early 15th century. And you have heard a beautiful, florid, very moving upper line sung by our countertenor Oscar. And a melody held in long notes here at the bottom notated the chant Benedict Camus Domino sung by the low voice by João. Also, you may observe that the low voice in fact looks like a chant. They're all square black notes. In this case, they have to be performed as longue, a long value in mezzo notation. And the upper part will show you how something like this could have been arrived at also through extemporization later on in the presentation. The third voice that you heard is nowhere to be seen. So this we have made up on the spot, but following a procedure that we do find in medieval sources, and I also will explain that later on in the presentation. Let's go into the laboratory. Now I invite you into my kitchen, and we are going to see what we can do, how we can make polyphony without composing it, without writing it. The first technique that we want to show to you is what in the Latin sources is known as quintare, in French cantoyer, and in Dutch, you'll be interested to know, there is even a Dutch, Middle Dutch word for this, quinteren. I found it in the Middle Dutch dictionary. It was practiced here, like anywhere else in the Western world, and really until very late. So this is a survival of course, of the parallel organum, the very earliest documented polyphonic technique that we know, out of already the earliest treatises, 8th, 9th century mention, singing in parallel organum, and this really survives until the late 15th century, in written out pieces, and in treatises telling you how to do this. So you have to imagine that this is the lifetime of Josquin des Prez. You have, Missa Pangelingua, and in another, maybe a little bit smaller or poorer church, people are singing parallel fifths. That gives you a little bit of a sort of sense of what kind of a diversity of music making went on in the late Middle Ages. We'll give you a short example of this. What is interesting to know is, for this technique, this particular kind of parallel organum is not just parallel. But as the author I quote also says, for this type of discant, it is necessary to know the octave, this is the duplum, and the quinta, the fifth of every note. So if you want to start with this thing, discant, you have to know the fifth of every note and the octave. And we'll see that that's very important, because Santo, who is going to improvise for you now, will use a lot of octaves as well as fifths. It's not strictly parallel, but very nearly so.
Ramos.
Now we move on to what we could call real polyphony. Yeah? This was mostly in parallel, so it's a little bit like, oh, is this really artful and so on? I think it can be, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. And what in the 14th century they call proper polyphony is discantus, and discantus is from D, or actually dis and cantus. So it's either two songs, or it is a kind of anti-singing, discantare. So they describe this, that if the cantus goes up, the discantus goes down. So it's a continuous cross shape of the voices, not in such a percussive way. And the treatises describe this with a terminology that's called species vicinori. So there are consonances which are lying right next to each other, for instance, unison, third, fifth, and that makes out of a lot of the things you can use in this technique. So actually, we have found that this doing this type of discant is actually not that much more difficult than singing parallel fifths. You just have to know a little trick. And they will demonstrate it now for you. And they will use the Guidonian hand. Santo will use the Guidonian hand to indicate, this is a kind of a mental representation of this medieval scale. So here, for instance, is the note Re, Di, Mi, Fa, Sol, La. And they are going to show how when one singer points out the melody on the hand, the other one can move exactly in contrary motion first, as long as they stay within the fifth.
La,
exact cross. What happens now when we want to put another note? When Santo is going to sing not Re Mi Fa Sol La, but for instance he's going to sing La Sol Fa Mi Re Do. Let's see what happens.
Re Sol Fa Sol La Si.
Yeah, this is not allowed in the 14th century. At least not in this in this sense. The seventh is not a consonant. So what do we do to avoid this? João can sing two notes in the space of one. He can sing the fifth, the sixth, and then to the octave, or he can simply go directly from fifth to octave. So he can sing La Do above Re Do, and then the whole problem is solved. Wonderful. So now we have an entire octave. Let's see how this comes back in compositions from this time. This is a little snippet of a verbum caro, a sequence notated in a triple rhythm, which is very usual for these things. It's a kind of modal rhythm as we already have in the 13th century. And you may observe, if you can see the slide clearly enough, that there is an axis running through the F in this melody, and that all the intervals of the second voice, so the lower part, are mirrored exactly in this F, except in this bit, which is inserted for a little bit of variety. But otherwise, an F always gets an E, an A always gets a D, a B flat gets another B flat, and that is the only consonances that are in this piece. So it's a kind of trick, and this is somebody who actually sat down to write this, so it must have been quite common. It sounds very nice, but it in principle is very simple, and you have to of course know a couple of other tricks, it is certainly within half a year of some regular work or so, you can learn to improvise this kind of thing. And we have prepared for you another sequence, a little piece from a French manuscript called Ave Virgo Virginum, which is a trope of another much more well-known piece. And we are going to do this like a kind of jam session. So all the guys are going to sing the Cantus Firmus together, and then each of them takes a turn to improvise on the verse that we have just sung. So you hear the same music twice, as always happens in a sequence. The music is repeated one time with a different text. And the second time it comes back, you hear a polyphony. And for the Amen, we have a little surprise for you.
Ave Virgo Virginum, Ave Lumen Luminum, Dolenti Solatium.
Have a discantus simplex, but in the end, in the Amen, you also had a piece of, let's call it, mandrill three-voice discant with even a little hocket at the end. And we'll show you later how we have practiced that. First, of course, we're still into voices. How do we get from this to something like this? The piece that you heard in the beginning. So, how the treatises describe floor discant, so discant in which one of the parts, at least one of the parts, is moving quicker than the other one, is that it's a breaking up of the simple counterpoint that is underlying it. So you can imagine, for instance, you have these pillars there, and there is a nice arch on top of them with an ornament. And so these are the pillars of the music. There, every time the note of the Cantus Firmus changes, also the note of the discantus changes, and that is the basic structure, the basic framework of the improvisation. And this is then filled out with ornaments, which they call fracciones, or flores musicae mensurabilis, the flowers of mensural music. And this is a kind of what in later time you would call diminutions. So there, it's a breaking up of the counterpoint, like when light falls through a crystal, it gives different colors. And this is the way in which the underlying counterpoint can be made more beautiful by putting small notes in between. And we'll demonstrate that for you in a very short, because we don't have that much time, but there is a small Cantus Firmus here on the slide, and Oscar and Joao are going to show you how we have practiced singing this kind of floor discant. Oscar is first going to sing only one note against every note of the Cantus Firmus, so this is now a discantus simplex, as you have also heard it.
Veritas me
nice, very simple. Now we make it a bit more difficult. The most simple kind of diminution is to sing two notes instead of one. So this is later time, this will be called second species counterpoint. Difficult. Now we're going to give Oscar free rein. We have also practiced a little bit these melodic formulas, so what he's going to do is take from his memory some melodic formulas that we have practiced and paste them on top of this structure. So we get a nice flowing melody in the same vein as you have seen in the Benedicamus Domino. Pretty. Thank you. So, now we go into three voice singing. There is one technique, it's very interesting example of how these treatises can be really inspiring a practice of reconstructing early music, is this little chapter from the Quattro Principalia, one of the manuscripts, the theoretical sources I talked about earlier, and this describes a kind of fake 3, 4, 5, 6 voice discant, and it describes a way to make multi-voice polyphony when you don't have the singers who can do this. So what happens is that one of these one singer who is an expert in discant, he specifies that he's an expert, sings a florid voice, while the others sing a kind of fifthing. So like what Santo has done. So in principle they sing parallel fifths, octaves, etc., like in parallel organum, and they amplify the sound of this kind of thing, and they make some ornaments as well, but there is only one voice who is actually really making a discant. And this can sound, according to the author, as if 5, 6 or so people are improvising simultaneously. But it's a kind of trick, but it's still really great fun. And he actually describes this with the words, magnam melodiam. So this makes a great sound, a great harmony. So we'll see how that works. I have an example from a piece, which is also from Britain, like the source, that illustrates this practice very well. And this is a piece, Constantus has taught, a little psalm verse, so it's also nice and short. And you will see that, like in this example, in almost the entire piece, the lower two voices are moving exactly in parallel fifths. And the top voice sings this kind of melody that Oscar has just shown you in improvisation. And what is very interesting is that when the top part sings sixths, of course, there's going to be a clash with the middle part.
Peace. I found that sounds really great. That has a fantastic acoustic quality, and the author is absolutely right. This is a great sound. Okay, so we can also do this ourselves, no? Here is again Veritas Mea, which you have just heard in a two-voice version. And now you will get the three-voice version with Santo basically doubling at the fifth, the cantus fervus. You will assess the difference. To make a real three-voice discantus, so discantus, remember, means that the parts are in contrary motion, there are some other criteria, but that's the main one. How do we go about this? So this is again, there are two quotations from this treatise, this Quattro Principali a Musicae, which is a very good treatise. The author spent a lot of time thinking about multi-voice polyphony. In the first quote you see, that what he finds very important is a kind of plenitude of sound. So the idea is that we are having three separate pitches, that there are no doublings between the voices. So what he also says is that so if one of them concurrit with another singer in the same note, in concordancia alterius, he has to quickly change to another pitch to restore this three voice thing. So you note I am in the pitch of the other guy, I go to another note. Another thing what he says is very interesting, because this music of course has lots of voice crossings, is that when one of the voices is going below the notated plain chant, the other singer that wants to sing above has to be expertus de gravium vocum sedibus. He has to know, in other words, what the lower singer is going to sing as notes. So you have to predict what the other guy is going to do and sing something that is good both with the written voice and with the voice that is not written down. Now this may sound like some kind of higher mathematics, but when you have this kind of common cliches, like the crossing discount that we have found, and there are a couple of other progressions that you can really practice, it's not impossible. And it is very hard though, so I will be singing myself the top part of this with the triplum, which is the hardest part. So it has to take into account not only the written part, but kind of predict what the part below, crossing below, is going to do. And because this is a little bit difficult to do while presenting, I'm now going to give my presentation tools to my colleague Oscar Verhaar, and I'm going to join the singers there at the stand.
And all of that to make clear who is the real expertus of all of us. We have for you a famous Kyrie, a plain chant in the first voice. That is just a well-known plain chant. And in this version of the Tourne manuscript, there are two other voices. And if you look at the second voice, this has been constructed in contrary motion. So there is the axis on G, and the second voice always does what the first voice does not. So up and down in contrary motion, and going around the G, then going around the A in the second part, and back to G for the end. Can we give an example of that?
Yeah.
So this composition, this written piece, uses the same technique as we used before for improvisation. And here there's a third voice, and what is the objective of this voice is also to use contrary motion and then to fill in the intervals that he has to sing. You also see the black notes in this transcription and only in the third voice. So there's a bit more freedom in that voice to find the spaces that are left. Final result. Now we go back to the lab and explain how you can practice this to use it as an improvisation technique. Here is a small scale of the fifth for the lower two voices, and the axis here is in the F mode, but just for this example you can use this in any mode. The axis here is on A, and the two lower voices will go in contrary motion. So the third voice, if we want to add it, he can sort of predict what the other two voices, well, one voice is written, what the second voice is going to do, because there are only so many options in this crossing pattern that he will use. The third voice needs to listen carefully to that and sort of predict what's going to happen, and then he can fill in the notes that are sounding well above that. If we take another cantus firmus, we can show how this works for an actual piece that we can now create for you. Let's see the bottom voices, how we can make a two-voice piece out of this. How you build a three-voice piece out of a single line, but we showed the intermediate stage of having two voices. If we take another cantus firmus, we can also show how it's done in three voices immediately.
Benedicamus, no.
Now, if you want to compare this to some of the music we have already seen that was written, in the Verbum Caro, there was a specific rhythm, a modal rhythm, in the written piece. But we can also incorporate that in an improvisation, can't we? So that as a first step, and then often in the 14th century you see a technique called hocket, a specific technique in which the melody sort of is interrupted between the voices so that you get a sort of hiccups, pop, 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 and also that is possible to incorporate in an improvisation as another type of ornament. Are you guys ready to try? Yeah?
So
okay.
Should we take the second mode? The second mode.
Benedicamus
Why do we all do this? It's great fun, and you learn a lot, not only about early music, but just about singing and about yourself, about your friends. But it also teaches you a lot about the music that it left to us from that time. And for instance, this is a little snippet of the Mass of Tournai, the Messe de Tournai, which you can hear tomorrow night in the version of the Trio Medieval. Actually, it's this part, at least, of the Mass is constructed exactly like what we have improvised. The lowest voice, which kind of functions like a cantus firmus, has an axis running through A. All the pitches of the middle voice are mirrored exactly in this A. And you have a top voice, which, much like mine, makes sometimes parallel fifths with all the other ones, because that's the only thing you can do, and generally tries to save the final result whilst adding something to it. So this is really a structure that you find in a composition, including also this hocket and the modal rhythm, etc. And as a kind of dessert, and for you to be able to assess the relationship between what could be improvised and what was written down, we will perform for you the Sanctus of the Messe de Tournai, and you will be able to judge for yourself if that sounds anything like what we have just improvised for you. Thank you very much.